Hi, this is Dan Letha, and I'd like to share with you a very personal experience of mine. I experienced something 40 years ago today that was the most tragic thing that I've ever been involved in. And yet, there's hope. There's good news here. So whether you know the people involved or not, I think that there's something that will encourage you in this video, and I hope you give it a watch. And then later on, please share. All right. Thanks for watching. In memory of Dave and Dan Helwig, missing you for 40 years, today. To start my presentation, I like to read Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. These are two popular verses. Perhaps you've seen them online, or maybe even have them displayed in your home. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths. These two verses meant a lot to me a little more than 40 years ago, but 40 years ago they became much more meaningful, and I hope that after listening to this video, they mean more to you too. My journey actually begins in the state of Michigan. I know that many people probably think that I'm from Minnesota because I talk about a particular sports team from Minnesota quite a lot, but no, my start started in Michigan. In fact, Michigan as a state is divided into two different sections. So you've got the Lower Peninsula and the Upper Peninsula. My hometown is in the upper part, the prettier part, and it's a town called Marquette. So I lived off the south shore of Lake Superior, beautiful area of the world to live in. So just to tell you a little bit about the Upper Peninsula, we get a lot of snow there. I grew up with lots of snow, and this is a display that you'll find up in the Keweenaw Peninsula. And they get a ton of snow there. In fact, the amount of snow, this is the record snowfall for the Upper Peninsula, 390.4 inches, over 30 feet of snow in the winter of 78 and 79. So that's a lot of snow. To put that in context, there's a particular city that gets lots of attention for their snow, Buffalo, New York. And so I found this, the record received for Buffalo, New York is almost 200 inches of snow. Mayville, I assume that's an area not too far from there, 290 inches. Again, still quite short from the record in the UP. So yeah, we get a lot of snow. Not a lot of credit because we're off in the sticks. Buffalo's more famous, big city and all that, but hey, if you want a lot of snow, go to the UP. So I've had a lot of fun with the snowy aspect of the UP over the years. This was a calendar that I made back in 1992. Snowflakes with attitudes, and that's no kidding. All right, so my journey post-womb actually began in 1964. So I tell people that's back when I was young and good-looking. So, but the Lord placed me in a family. This is my family, my dad and mom and my little brother, Mark. And so I'm thankful for these people that God has placed me in a family with. This particular family made an important decision probably around the time that this photo was taken. My parents decided to change churches. They did so out of conviction and various reasons, but this decision actually opened the door for a whole bunch of very important things for me to happen. Vitally, vitally important. So I thank my parents for making that decision and changing their course in direction because it affected both my life and my brother's. And so I want to tell you about that. In 2 Timothy 1:5, it says, I have been reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am also persuaded now lives in you. And this verse talks about some ladies, women in a particular life that have influenced this person. Okay, that's happened to me. There have been women in my life. I'm very thankful for my mom. She's definitely one of them. There's some others too that have impacted my life. And so I want to tell you about those ladies in the course of my presentation today. The first one is Ruth Connor. Now, Ruth, I met her when I was very, very little. And she was known in our area as kind of a child evangelist. She was a missionary to children. And she went around the UP and she dedicated her life to making sure that children knew and could learn the gospel and that the Bible is true and all those things about Christian living. So she was a delightful lady, and when she shared the gospel with her audiences of children, she didn't have PowerPoint or any of the electronic whiz-bang features that we have today. She used something very simple, a flannel graph board. And so this was there was a background, and then these little figures that you see on there, the swans and the people and the ark or whatever, and the animals, they would all kind of stick to it. And so she could tell a story and then add and take away things as need be, and then eventually change the background and such. Very effective way back then. And this actually helped me come to Christ. I received Christ as my Lord and Savior through the ministry of Ruth Connor. And she gave a presentation one Wednesday night to a bunch of kids during the adults' Bible study. She was taking care of the kids. And she told us, and I remember this, all of us are sinners. And so that's bad news. Kids need to know this bad news. It's very, very important for all of us to know that bad news. And then another piece of that bad news is that God does not allow sin in heaven. Two very important things to know. Again, very difficult and hard, but important. So Noah, back in his day, God judged sin very seriously with a worldwide flood. And yet he was gracious and provided a savior or an ark to save the family of Noah. So sin is very serious in God's eyes. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." None of us are good enough to get to heaven. The Bible says all of us are sinners, and so something has to be done about that sin before we can even think about going to heaven. So think about that in your own life too. But the good news is then Jesus came to the earth to save sinners. So we celebrate Christmas, Jesus coming to earth as a baby, but that baby would then grow up, live a perfect life, and then die on a cross. Why did he die? Because he was paying the penalty, the price for our sin. He was the sacrifice in our place. He endured what we should endure. And John 3:16-17 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." That's good news. And so then because of that act on Jesus' behalf, paying the price for our sin, if we receive that free gift of salvation that he offers to us, and he certainly does, and I want to tell you about that today, we can know that after this life is over, that we'll be in his presence forever in heaven. Romans 10:13 says, "For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." And that's a promise, and I took Ruth up on that offer. I remember it was a Wednesday night, and she had us, all the kids, bow our heads, and then she, after this presentation of what Jesus has done for us and the hope of heaven, and she asked us, who here wants to go to heaven? I was a child of maybe 5 or 6 years old, something like that, and I thought, man, I don't know that I am going to heaven, and so I did, and what she said made sense to me, and so I wanted that free gift, and so I raised my hand, she took me back, and she talked with me. It's not just like something you just do and then you're off on your merry way living your life. Jesus wants you to give him your life. He wants you to follow him and be your Lord and Savior. So I prayed with Ruth. It's not that the prayer saved me, but I was letting God know that I wanted his free gift of salvation and that I loved him and wanted to follow him. And so I was saved. And then 1 John 2:25 says, "And this is the promise that he has promised us, eternal life." And so now, because I've received that free gift from God, I know that I have eternal life. I have that hope of going to heaven someday. That's the Bible tells us how to do that. So many people think, oh, I'm good enough, I'll get there. But they never check the owner of the place, right? God is the one that created heaven. He made it. He's the one that makes the rules, so we need to follow him to get there. So many years later, in fact, in 2002, I was at work, and I received a phone call, and it said that Ruth had passed away. She had died. And so I made this cartoon in honor and memory of her. So here I'm sitting at my desk and the lady calls and she says, "Dan, I called to tell you that the lady who led you to the Lord just went to heaven to be with him." Well, she did introduce me to Jesus once, and someday she'll introduce me to Jesus again. She's there right now. And so someday I'll go there and maybe Ruth will be there and she'll say, here's the one I told you about when you were little. And that'll be a glorious day. So thank you, Lord, for Ruth, one of the very, very important women in my life. I am blessed eternally because of her ministry and her presence in my life. So again, about that time, my art career actually took off or got going. So I'm in this picture. Can you find me? Do you know where I am? I'll give you a hint. I'm in the front row holding the sign. So that's me at a young age, and I had started drawing, and dinosaurs and monsters were actually one of my favorite things at that early age. You know, boys like to draw stuff like that. Now, this wasn't demonic stuff, wrong things, but my teachers really didn't appreciate the dinosaurs and monsters. They just thought, oh, it's just silly, crazy stuff. And so I remember them telling me, why can't you draw something more constructive? And so they weren't real positive about that. And I could have been discouraged, but I didn't really listen to them, because I liked drawing dinosaurs and monsters so much. And so I kept on doing it. And I'm really glad that I did, because years later, I've made a living out of drawing dinosaurs and monsters. And so here's some of the samples of books that I've illustrated with dinosaurs and dragons and such in them. And again, over the years, I've drawn hundreds and hundreds of cartoons and such of dinosaurs, communicating the truth of dinosaurs and how they fit into the world history with the biblical account in mind. So I've gotten a great amount of joy out of drawing dinosaurs and monsters. Well, I continue to draw different things as I grew up. This is a poster that I won a contest to in my hometown. And actually, I sent a picture of this to the president in the White House at the time, was Jimmy Carter. And they actually got we got a letter back from the White House, which was really big news in my little town and my house. But so that was fun. And then in senior high, I started drawing some wildlife, more realistic type things. And faces were also something that were of interest to me at that time. So, and they still are. Tom Selleck back in the early 80s was very, very popular with the TV show Magnum P.I. And so there was a picture that I drew. I didn't trace this. I drew it. And it's kind of sloppy looking to me now. But anyway, photocopiers had come into access to the general public. And so there was a store in our town that had photocopiers. I took this picture to the store and had a bunch of photocopies made. And then I went back to my high school and I sold them to the girls for 25 cents a piece and made a bunch of money. So the young entrepreneur. So thank you, Tom Selleck, for that. It's fun memory. Now I have to go back in time a little bit here, because I met the Helwig family in our church. That's the church that I grew up in. And so Sue Helwig, we call her Suzanne now, was the first family member of that family that I met. And I was in junior high. And so my brother and I were these greasy, grimy little junior hires. And Sue had seen us. And so she kind of felt the Lord telling her, giving her a little nudge, saying, "Why don't you get to know those guys and help them in their faith? Help them to get to know me better." And her first response was, you know, kind of like Jonah in the Bible, where he heard that thing from the Lord and he's like, "I don't want to do that." And so he runs away and flees. But thankfully, she wrestled with that for a short time. And then she said, "Okay, Lord, here am I. Send me," more like Isaiah. So the fruit of her turning around and obeying that little nudge and turned into a wonderful friendship. It was a time of biblical growth and just getting to know the Bible more and praying and all those things. So I'm really thankful for Suzanne in my life and her taking that step of obedience. It actually turned into something very, very rewarding for both of us. We became best friends. In high school, we were best friends. And so you might say, "Hey, come on, that looks romantic." It never was, never was. We were just best friends, very, very close. And in fact, Sue's got kind of a bit of a matchmaker side to her too. And years later, she introduced me to Marcia McIntosh, who's Sue's cousin. And so this little matchmaking endeavor of Sue's paid off, because Marcia McIntosh years later became Marshall Etha. So another benefit of knowing Sue and her friendship. So thank you, Suzanne, for that, for helping me meet my wife, and for introducing me to the rest of your family, which I met shortly after I met Suzanne. And so there's Opal and Carl, her parents, very dear people. Carl is now with the Lord. And Dave, Dan, and Bill, three of her brothers. Now, she has two older siblings, Jean and Carl Lee. And so Carl Lee is referenced in a video that I'm going to show you in a little bit. But so a little bigger family. But Dave, Dan, and Bill will be the main focus of our time today. Dave, Dan, and Bill actually are important in my life for many, many reasons, but one of them is that they built and owned and operated the Peninsula Roller Skating Center in my hometown. A wonderful place of entertainment. So many people from my hometown have great memories of the roller rink, and I know that some of you that are listening right now are just thinking about all the fun times that you had there. And it was not only just a fun place to be, but there was ministry. There was Christian things happening in this rink. We had a Christian music session, there were Bible studies, and I know that there's kids that were led to the Lord inside this roller rink. So, wonderful, wonderful place. And just take note of that little motorhome down there. You're going to be seeing that in slides to come. So there's me. I was actually one of the original employees of the Peninsula Roller Skating Center, and I got so much experience that I'm still using to this day. I started out as a skate counter worker, and then I went to the floor guard. I got to know how to do that, and increased my roller skating skills exponentially. and then eventually I was a DJ, and so that announcing and presenting in front of people was something that I think I really started at the roller rink. And then I did advertising artwork too. So here's one of my posters, and there's some comic strips that I used to do on a weekly basis as an advertisement for the roller rink, and then other ads ran artwork of mine as well. So I was designing and coming up with ideas for comic strips and learning how all of that worked. So I'm so thankful for the Helwig family for just giving me that opportunity to have that experience. I'm still benefiting from those things to this day. Well, we did a lot of fun stuff in our community. 4th of July parades were a fun time where we could get a truck with the roller dog costume in the back and throw candy out, and then a bunch of us would do trick skating through the parade route. And so here's a picture of my brother, my younger brother Mark. He's got the clown suit on, and there I am doing some trick skating, and we just had a blast putting on a show for the kids and for the adults and such. So fun times at the roller rink. Well, another fun thing that we did at the roller rink was in the off hours, we would play roller soccer. So I want you to pay attention to some of the stuff that these guys are wearing in the roller soccer game, the pads and helmets and things, wrist guards, because we're going to be seeing those in just a little bit. One side note here is it was really fun to invite new people to play soccer and watch them try to kick a soccer ball for the first time on roller skates. Fun stuff. All right, so another thing that happened at the roller rink on a pretty consistent basis was fundraisers for the American Heart Association. And how these would operate usually was that the kids would go out in their community, get a bunch of people to pledge money for how many laps they would do, and then they would, you know, raise whatever that amount was. Well, these sessions aren't the most exciting thing. And so my friends, Dave, Dan, and Bill, being the more adventurous type, came up with a different idea for raising money for the Heart Association. And so they thought, hey, well, let's do a trip out west where their older brother was a pastor at the time. And we'll do a Skate West trip during the month of July, 1982. I graduated that year from high school, so I was just fresh out of high school. And they would be adventurous, like I said. So This adventure was actually covered by a news group in Wisconsin. There was a TV show called PM Magazine, and that had affiliates all over the United States. And the one in Green Bay covered this trip. And this news article that they produced was submitted to the national headquarters, and it was the very first one that group in Green Bay had done that made it national. So it made the national show. And so now I get to play in its entirety that PM Magazine segment. Here it is.
That's Bill, Dan, and Dave Helwig, the Buzzard Brothers of Marquette, Michigan. They are proudly presenting a check for almost $4,000 to Cy Barsh, board chairman-elect of the Michigan Heart Association. Now, the Buzzard Brothers aren't philanthropic millionaires, far from it. They got that handsome sum of money from almost 1,000 sponsors for roller skating, not around the rink they own, but along the highways of the upper Midwest. To be exact, it was a 31-day skate west from Marquette, Michigan to 180 miles inside Montana, a total of 1,003 sweltering hot, grueling, hard-earned miles.
Well, I came up with the idea back a couple months ago in the middle of the night. One night I turned on the light and wrote it down and told Bill and Dave in the morning they liked the idea.
The Heart Association is very much supportive of exercise as a prevention for heart disease. We were just real thrilled to be involved with them.
Sponsors came easily. People from all over Upper Michigan sent money, food, and equipment. Roller rinks from all over the country sent their money and support. But if the Buzzard Brothers couldn't hack the trip, it was all for nothing. So besides the 8 hours they often spend on skates each day at the rink, they started skating 10 to 15 miles each night out on the road for the last 2 weeks before the trip. June 30th, 1982, at the stroke of midnight, they would leave. Their goal? To skate the entire month of July, all 31 days, and hoping to reach Broadus, Montana, where their oldest brother lives. The hour it struck, it was July 1st. They swapped their final hugs and kisses with their wives, and then the Buzzard Brothers embarked on the most remarkable undertaking of their lives.
Take care of this place while we're gone. Oh, yeah.
The first night, they skated an impressive 56 miles. They'd have to average over 32 miles per day throughout the trip, so they were well on their way.
Michigan was pretty easy to get out of, and we had a lot of people along the way honking and waving and stuff like that. There was a family that left three cans of Coke on the side of the road with a note stuck in the middle. Hope you enjoy these. And
good luck, guys.
July 4th, they entered Wisconsin.
And there's a lot of hills. There's a lot of up and down and up and down. And I think that's where we really had our first test. We're getting really sore, breaking our legs in and stuff. And sometimes those hills are just killers.
Actually, their first test was getting permission to skate through Wisconsin.
They told us that we wouldn't be allowed to skate through their state because there is a statute on their books that says that play vehicles are not allowed on the Wisconsin roadway, and roller skates are classified as a play vehicle in that state. So they said no way.
An appeal to the governor voided the statute in their case. The governor was willing to make an exception. On July 8th, they were in Duluth, Minnesota, expecting good media coverage, which they had arranged all along the way so they could hopefully keep filling the kitty for the Heart Association.
There's no news anywhere, and we were wondering, well, they all seemed interested, and they all said they would show up for us. The officer who was escorting us told us that what was on the police radio back and forth all morning was that a moose was sighted in the city, and I guess he drew all the media.
They were in Minnesota for the next 8 days, passing the midpoint on their journey, and still no major setbacks. Bill and Dave each took a spill. Bill skinned his knee and Dave hurt his arm, but by and large, blisters, sore muscles, and the heat were the daily antagonists.
Being tired. The blisters.
We sweat a lot and we drink a lot of water, but we survive.
On July 16th, they entered North Dakota, just one state line away from their goal. However, the North Dakota State Police expected them to skate straight through. North Dakota is a long state.
And the police chief was very upset. He was very upset that we didn't finish skating all the way through North Dakota in one shot. Which was humanly impossible.
As it turns out, they would spend 10 days rolling through North Dakota. July 26th, the Buzzard Brothers crossed the Montana state line. 5 days of skating were left, 1,000 miles easily within their grasp. So they skated by day, visited their brother close by at night, were even treated to a real Western-style ranch barbecue. And by the 31st of July, after an entire month of roller skating over hill and dale, they did it. 1,003 miles and one regret.
I've learned that I don't like to be away for that long.
Dan, Bill, and Dave hopped in the van and drove straight through back to Marquette to the open arms of their wives, kids, parents, friends, and neighbors anxiously waiting at the roller rink. It was an incredible journey with lots of memories.
Our longest day was 71 miles, and that day we...
The blisters, the long nights, the first night.
It was worth it in a physical way because it helped all three of us get in a lot better shape and...
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. I liked it.
The blisters.
We got to know each other a lot better.
We just worked good as a team.
Raising money for the Heart Association is a cause we can all appreciate, and I'm sure the Buzzard Brothers have a very special appreciation for every one of the $4,000 they raised. But will they ever do it again by roller skating cross country?
I'm not.
So did you see me in the video? Well, here's a bit of trivia that most people don't know. I wasn't actually the first person chosen to be the support vehicle driver. They had somebody else doing that job, and that person actually got in a bit of trouble in the first few days of the trip. And so in an emergency panic, they thought of me, and they thought, oh, Dan's not doing anything. He just graduated high school. And so I remember them coming with Opal to my house and saying, hey, we're in a kind of a pickle here. Can you help us out? And so I really wasn't doing anything. So I dropped what little I was doing and said, sure. So I became at that point the driver, the support vehicle person. So I am in the video. So did you see me? Actually, there I am. I'm driving the van at that point. They didn't even make it out of the state of Michigan before they had to swap drivers. So for everything from the end of the Upper Peninsula of Michigan through the rest of the trip is all me. So there I am. And then I actually, you can see me just a little bit in this ending that they had us do for the cameras. That was all kind of mocked up. You know, that wasn't an actual greeting like that, but that was all done for stage type stuff. And so the guys come through the door and everyone rushes us and gives us big hugs for the cameras. And so if you look really close, you can see the tip of my head right there. So there I am, the support guy that, I'm not the star of the show, so I'm not that important to be seen on camera. You'll hear the trips talked about as the three guys that went on this trip. There were four, but I'm kind of the unknown soldier. All right, so Buzzard Brothers. You might think, well, that's kind of a weird nickname. Okay, well, Buzzard is the nickname for Dan Helwig. So there were two Dans on the trip. It was very helpful that we called him Buzzard because then it wasn't like Dan and both of us would turn our heads. So he had a rally car and he would drive that car. And so anyone that helped him on his team, well, his brothers really, were his support vehicle drivers and navigator and such. So that was the Buzzard Brothers team. So, again, very adventurous, fun guys. And I want to return to the very end of the video that I just showed you. So let's take a look at what Bill said.
I'm sure the Buzzard Brothers have a very special appreciation for every one of the $4,000 they raised. But will they ever do it again by roller skating cross country?
I'm not.
Yeah, Bill was. We weren't like, oh, that was so horrible. We had a great time, but we just never thought that we would ever do that again. 1 month away from home, and all the effort that was put into it. Well, that's what we all thought. And so we were just moving on with our lives. I was scheduled and approved to go to the Joe Kubert School of Cartoon and Graphic Art to really get my career going, and that had to be put on hold because Mattel Toys came a calling, and they were looking for a team of roller skaters that had cross-country roller skating experience. And the only guys that they could find with that experience were my friends Dave, Dan, and Bill. So Mattel had a plan to promote their dolls called Baby Skates. They had these dolls that you could wind up and they would skate across the floor or whatever. And so to promote them, they thought, hey, we could get a group of guys that would do this marathon session, roller skating across the United States, stop off in all the big cities, and they could do like a promotional party at the roller rinks and give away dolls, and it would be a big, big thing. And so that's what we did. We agreed to do that. But at the same time, we thought, well, we just don't want to go across the states for just the doll. Let's get the American Heart Association back into this, give that trip a bit more value in our eyes. So we did that, and that was a fundraiser for them again as well. So the trip again was supposed to be 3,800 miles, quite a bit longer than the first trip. And it started September 18th, 1983. And to do this trip, things were a little bit different. The first trip, we had a van and then a motorhome, or not a motorhome, but a trailer or a camper. And so we would put the camper up a number of miles ahead, and then we would skate up to it and then past it, and then we would move the camper to the next site, and then the traveling was done in the van. Well, this time, instead of three skaters skating at the same time, it was to be one skater at a time. So they skated in relay, and we had a 30-foot motorhome, and to be as safe as we possibly could, we put these big flashing yellow beacons up on the back of the motorhome to make it very visible, especially when we skated after dark. So whenever we were skating, those lights were flashing, letting people know, you know, caution, and it was great. They worked wonderful. And so the guys got new uniforms, and the pants that they're wearing there had padding in them for skating, and so they had a new look. We've got a new vehicle. And so here's a video that was captured in Pennsylvania, so give you a taste of what the trip was like.
Dan Helwig and his brothers will travel 3,800 miles in their roller skating journey from Boston to Los Angeles. Skating in shifts of approximately 20 miles each, the three brothers are heading west in an effort to raise money for the American Heart Association. The money's being donated by various skating rinks in cities the three travel through on their way west. Also skating with them is Baby Skates. UC Mattel Toys is underwriting the expense of the trip. The three stopped long enough today to tell me that this is their second marathon skating trip in as many years. Last year, they skated 1,000 miles for the same charity.
It's a very interesting way to see the country, but like after the 1,000-mile skate last year, I didn't think that I would be skating again. And now here we are going coast to coast. This is crazy.
So today they are roller skating through Westmoreland County on their way to Pittsburgh, these three brothers. They expect to be in Pittsburgh sometime tonight or tomorrow. A lot of that will depend on traffic. They will be in Pittsburgh at Spinning Wheels on Wednesday the 5th, and they'll be appearing throughout the country on their way to Los Angeles. In Irwin, this is Ron Klink, TV2 Eyewitness News.
Okay, a couple things to notice. Actually, three things. One, the timing on that end was perfect. That was done one time. That one take was absolutely perfect. Two, did you see me? Again, nobody cares about the support guy. And three, anytime you see the skater skating, they've got a backpack on their back. There's a doll in that backpack, so we could say that Baby Skates skated across the country. That's what that was all about. So, again, fun stuff. Now, there had to be a fourth person because part of my job was to take photos. And so here's a collection of a few photographs from across the country as we were traveling along. This one was taken in New York City. And I think it's very, very funny because very, very busy traffic and all that stuff. They were waiting by phone booths to call the news media to schedule a meeting so that we could have a photo op and all that sort of stuff. So much different time, phone booths and all that. But again, here's three grown men in these kind of outlandish suits, funny pants, and walking around with a doll. So just makes me smile. And this picture right here really captures, again, like the video that you saw earlier. Dan is skating right next to the white line, and the motorhome is about that far back to be a guard. And then there's you see the flash of the beacons up on the back of the motorhome. And so we want to protect the skater from traffic that would be coming up behind us. And again, this was just put on for show for the photographer there for that newspaper at that time. So again, these media events and such were very, very important. Here we're approaching the Smoky Mountains. Bill's skating, and so he's about to encounter some ups and downs. And so I wanted to get this chronicled in a photo so that we could say, here's some of the interesting terrain that was tackled on the trip. And Bill was a trooper. He did a lot of big ups and downs. And so we stopped to take some of the pictures because that just makes a great picture right there. But he did a lot of work. And so people ask the questions when I tell them about this this event, these trips. And a couple of the questions are, one, did you wear your wheels out? I mean, how many wheels did you use? And actually, these wheels, which are skateboard wheels, were used on the first trip. So I'm not sure if they replaced them during this trip. They may have, but they don't wear out as fast as you'd think. And how do you skate downhill? Well, here's Bill doing that. He's dragging one of his skates, slowing him down so that he's just not tearing down the mountain. And so if you're an experienced skater, that's really not a big trick, but and these guys certainly were, so that's how they tackled the steeper inclines going down mountains. And again, here's some of the elevations that Bill had to go up and down from. And here he's not really that tired. He's tired, but he's more hamming it up for the camera. So again, fun times and great memories. Here we are in Detroit. And again, we've got the photographer for a newspaper, and here are these grown guys sitting around talking with a doll. baby skates. And this picture was taken in St. Louis. The big cities when we got there, we'd call the police, and they would give us police escorts through the cities as needed. And this one was a bit different because it was like a police motorcycle tricycle type thing. And so St. Louis is going to play an important role in important upcoming events. So pay attention to that. Again, the trip started September 18th. It was supposed to end December 10th, 1983. But God is in control, and his plans are different than ours many times. And so our plans were very different this time. And this trip actually ended in Texas on November 9th, 1983. 40 years ago today, as I'm recording this. Now, the video that you're about to see, there's footage in there that's reenactment video. This was reenacted for a trial that happened in Texas, and so some of the narration and such comes from that. And then there's the news story that the local news in Marquette on TV6 presented on the announcement that Dave and Dan had been killed in the accident. So listen to the mom and Opal and her answers to some of the questions she's asked. They were asked on purpose.
And we figured, well, if we go on this one, this will be the last skating marathon.
Little did Bill Helwig know that this coast-to-coast marathon would be their last skating challenge. They would never reach the West Coast, for on November 9th, 1983, the marathon would come to a fatal end in Texas. The brothers started skating late at night to avoid traffic. Dave decided to skate first, stopping Bill from getting ready. Dan Letha, a friend, would drive that night while Dave skated, and while Bill and Dan slept at the back of the motorhome. As Dave and the motorhome continued traveling west on Interstate 20 that night, on the same road behind them, a semi-tractor trailer truck was approaching. The truck was traveling 50 to 55 miles per hour in the right lane. Several vehicles passed the truck. Witnesses described the truck weaving dangerously across the road. Down the road in front of the truck is the RV, with Dave skating in front of it. But instead of passing by the RV and skater, like witness Thomas Hurdle, the semi-truck crashes into the back of the motor home, totally destroying the left half of it. Dan, who was sleeping in that section of the RV, was killed instantly. The truck then ran into Dave, brutally killing him upon impact.
The Helwig brothers were just a day and a month from finishing their trip promoting a new doll for Mattel when the accident happened this morning at 12:45. Texas Highway Patrol say their escort motorhome was traveling from 5 to 10 miles per hour on Interstate 20 in Weatherford when a semi slammed into the rear, killing 24-year-old Dan, who was sleeping in the back, and 28-year-old David, who was skating in front.
David was married and the father of two daughters. The third brother, Bill, was also sleeping in the motorhome, but he and the driver, Dan Letha, were not seriously injured. The team had been skating at night to stay on schedule and avoid heavy traffic.
They enjoyed doing different and unusual things. And we knew it was dangerous, but it was something they wanted to do and they enjoyed doing.
And that includes last year's 900-mile month-long skate to Montana, a fundraiser the brothers organized for the American Heart Association. The trio did many things as a team, including the ownership and management of Peninsula Roller Rink in Marquette, a job that's been filled by their mother and wives since the brothers have been on the road.
What's your biggest comfort now? The fact that we have faith, we know that we'll see them again. They were Christians and they knew that when they died they'd be in heaven with the Lord.
The news reporter that was asking those questions to Opal in that interview was also a Christian, and so that was her way of bringing out some gospel hope in this very sad and tragic announcement. So we are glad that we do have that hope that we'll see Dave and Dan again, and I want to talk about that in a little bit. Here's the semi-tractor trailer that hit the camper, the motorhome. We were told that it had a full load of car batteries on it, and so it was weighted down pretty well. It had a lot of oomph in it when it hit the motorhome. And here's the motorhome after the accident. Both these vehicles had been hauled to a wrecking yard from the highway. So you can see it's pretty well destroyed. This section right here, this corner, was where Dan's bed was. This part of the motorhome that doesn't exist anymore. That's where Dan's bed was right there. And so that's what happened to Dan. And, you know, two people were killed in this accident, and it very well could have been four. We came very, very close ourselves. I, of course, was sitting in the driver's seat, and Bill's bed was right in back of where I was driving. In fact, during the collision, I broke the back of the driver's seat. I went over on top of Bill, who was sleeping in back of me. So I injured him a little bit, and then I rolled off to the side and woke up on the floor. So I was out for just a brief time. And but Bill, when the motorhome was hit, he was propelled backwards into the wall that was right in back of him, which was the bathroom wall. His foot actually punched a hole in it, and as you can see, the bathroom is exposed to the outside. That's the bathroom sink. Right there. So again, we came very, very close ourselves. And then of course, natural gas is an issue. Sometimes that goes up and then it's curtains for everyone. So we're so glad and thankful that that did not happen. A lot of the news reports said that, the guys weren't injured and that sort of thing. Well, we weren't critically injured for sure, but I did break a bone in my neck. And so I wore a neck brace around for quite a long time. The morning, we were in the hospital that night. The next morning, the hospital called us and said, hey, I want you to come in. We think we see some bone chips. And so they found that I had broken, this isn't an x-ray of mine, but the little bumps on the back of your neck, those are called cervical processes. And I broke number 6 on mine. So when my head went back, that one went broke off. And thankfully, since in days recent, it's healed. So it's all back in one piece now. So I'm thankful for that. Now, again, when I share this story, a lot of people ask various questions. One question might be that, did the police know that you were out on the road that night? Was that a thing that you made sure that they knew about? And yes, it was. We actually got a police escort into Dallas and Fort Worth. And so the guys got a tour of the police station. So the police were very aware of what we were doing. And that night we called them and said, hey, we're going to go back on the road. A memo went out to all the police. And so shortly before the accident happened, I remember seeing this police car. It didn't go flying by us, but it drove by us. And this guy didn't stop. He didn't do anything, although he did do this. He flashed his lights at us like, hey, guys, you know, he acknowledged us and off he went and he was gone. And so that was something that we were able to talk about later on. But here's a diagram that I have to tell you first that it's not accurate to scale at all. my purpose in showing you this is the off-ramp dynamic there, the overpass, and then the on-ramp, okay? The distances are not right. Just, I want to be clear about that. So the motorhome and the skater were traveling down the side of the road, much like you've seen in those pictures. There had been some rumble strips earlier. We were on the shoulder, and then we had to move over just a little bit. So the skater was skating right next to the white line. The motorhome was just out in the first lane of traffic, just enough to guard the skater. And I have to back up and say that on the off-ramp right there, that was the last time I spoke to Dave. I was escorting him down the road. Both guys were asleep in the motorhome. Bill and Dan were asleep. So I had we had a CB radio with a speaker mounted in the front of the grill of the motorhome. And so I could make announcements and say things to the skater. And I had to tell him that there was no traffic coming, that it was all clear, and he could go across where that off-ramp is. So he zoomed across there, and then I said, "How you doing, Dave? You feeling all right?" And so he gave me a little burst of speed saying, "Yes, I'm doing good." And so that was the last time I spoke to Dave. We went up the little incline then, because there was a little bit of an upgrade to the overpass. And then at the overpass, it kind of flattened out, and then it went down slightly, a slight grade. So you can't really say it was a hill, but from the off-ramp position, you couldn't see over to the other side. It was that much, okay? But the distance was very great, and so it wasn't really a hill. Now, the truck, of course, was going a lot faster. He was not going straight like that, and I'll clarify that in just a little bit. But I want to put him at the point of the top of that upgrade, that grade up, where he could begin to see down to the other side, okay? And the distance between that point and where the collision happened was about 400 yards. Now, we were told that the semi-tractor trailer was going about 55 miles an hour. You know, whether that's true or not, I don't know. But given that speed and that distance, you can calculate that out. And so that's 15 seconds that he would have to make his decision to change lanes. How long does it take for you to change lanes? It does not take 15 seconds, even for a semi-tractor trailer. And he wouldn't actually even have to change the entire lane. Just the minimum would have been about a half lane. Okay, so, but here's the thing. The tractor trailer driver told the police that night after the accident that we were right in the middle of the road, that he couldn't miss us, and that he couldn't stop before he got to us. In fact, the news the next morning after the accident reported that. And so one of the Dallas police guys was quoted as saying that the truck didn't have a prayer of stopping in time. That's a quote that assumes, again, that we're in the middle of the lane. But I testified that night, too, that no, we weren't in the middle of the lane. The skater was on the white line, and the motorhome was mostly on the shoulder, but enough out in the lane to guard the skater. Later on that day, the next morning then, we went back to the scene of the accident, and there were skid marks there that confirmed what I said was true. But that being said, the police there at that time, whoever was on, you know, on part of the police staff, were not game to protect us or make us, they weren't in it for fairness. They actually were lying about a lot of things that tried to make the truck driver look good and us at fault. So that became an issue later on for sure. But again, here's how the skating happened. The skater was right next to the white line. How much space does a truck need to get around there? Thousands and thousands and thousands of vehicles prior to that had successfully, with no trouble, navigated around us. Why did this truck driver fail to do that? This is why. Again, we're still here. We were moving at the time, of course. But here's the skater. Here's me. There's Bill. And there's Dan sleeping in the motorhome. And the truck approached us. Witnesses tell us that he was weaving back and forth in the lane of traffic in the roadway. He was weaving on both lanes, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. And when he approached us, he hit us at such an angle that he sheared off. And you can see that if you look at the wreckage, how that matches what I'm showing you here, that he sheared off that section of motorhome where Dan was sleeping. And then that knocked us off to the side. So it propelled us up this embankment a little bit to the on-ramp. And Dan was taken out of the motorhome. The shock of the impact apparently alerted the truck driver. And so he corrected. And he went around and hit the skater. He hit Dave. And then he crossed in front of us. And then the motorhome continued to roll down the on-ramp. Now, at this point, I have to clarify that when news got back of what happened, people couldn't see this in their minds, and so they were imagining that the motorhome got pushed into the skater, and I was sitting in the driver's seat, and I saw the whole thing. I absolutely did not. In fact, I was knocked out, and I was on the floor when I woke up. I didn't see a thing. I didn't even know what happened. And that's another point, too. People sometimes say, well, did you see the truck coming in the rearview mirror? My answer to that is, I may have. I looked in the mirror thousands and thousands of times on that trip, and I saw traffic, switching lanes, and all that sort of stuff. And again, I only glimpse back at the mirror just to check things. I don't sit there and look at it. I look at the skater because he's right in front of me, and I'm trying to protect him, and I don't want to run over him if he fell down. So I'm imagining I probably glanced in the mirror, saw this truck coming, and it didn't look anything abnormal because I probably didn't glance long enough to see the weaving part. It may have looked like he was just changing lanes. So I was completely unaware of what happened until after the fact that we were hit. We came to a rest in the median then. We drifted all the way across the lanes of traffic again and came to a stop right there. So that's the dynamics of what happened during the collision, and I hope that answers a lot of questions for you. Again, when I share this, people ask these questions, and so I think it's important for me to show you the layout of what happened during this accident. Now, when I share this, and I've done this countless times, I don't know how many times in the last 40 years I've told camp groups and youth groups and people one-on-one that have suffered a loss in an accident or whatever. The Lord has allowed me to present this to many, many people. And so I don't mind, in a sense, reliving some of this for their benefit. That's been my honor, and I hope that they've benefited from that. But again, it's a sad story, and I'm not sharing this just to say, hey, there's a sad story. I want you to feel sad. I want you to have a perspective on life, and I want you to benefit from the hope that we talk about as well. It's not just sad. And there's a testimony here, the Helwig family testimony. They've influenced and impacted my life in so many ways. I'm so thankful that God has used them and placed them in my life. And the testimony that they've had with all the people that came to the rink that knew Dave and Dan and that continue to know the members of the family. And they're just a wonderful, godly family. And I love them so much. And I want to honor them with this video in memory of Dave and Dan. And so I don't have time to talk about a lot of different things that I wish I could, but one little thing that I want to tell you about in the way of God's provision in dealing with all of this is this little story right here. And it has to do with Opal. Now, again, you saw her in the interview, and she gave good answers to the lady that was interviewing her about the loss of her sons. But years later, in fact, it was 8 years later, I was talking about the accident to a church group with Opal. So we teamed up and talked about the accident. I heard her give testimony about this that I had never heard her say before. She said that she was giving good answers. In her head, she knew the things to say. In her heart, she was at a cold place in her faith. She was very let down. She felt let down by God. She had been praying fervently for our safety. And the end result of her prayers, it seemed, was that two of her sons were killed. And so she had a lot of questions, and she had a lot of grief and things to work through. And it was during that time then that we had come back from the trip, Bill and I, and we had sent the rolls of film in that I had taken on the trip. And those photos came back, and it's those photos that I want to tell you about. So, again, one of the photos, we had been in St. Louis, And during that time, I was running around St. Louis like a crazy guy, taking pictures of the arch because I thought it was just the coolest thing. I'd never seen it before. At that time then, in Lebanon, a U.S. embassy had been blown up by a terrorist truck full of explosives, and a bunch of U.S. Marines were killed. And so flags around the nation were in half staff. And so I wasn't paying attention to the flag. I was taking pictures of the arch. And yet, there it is, right in the center of this picture, memorializing some people that had died. And then another picture was taken in a Walmart parking lot in Arkansas. We had stopped there for the night and got up the next morning. We saw this really odd thing. How many graves are there? Two graves. Cemented off in this former farmer's field, I would assume. And it was just very, I've never seen that before. So I took a picture of it, and it's on the roll of pictures. And then this picture right here, I can't remember if it was a sunset or a sunrise, but Opal, when she sees it, she thinks of sunset, because that is a picture of the end of things, of the end of a day, of the end of life type of thing. And so those three pictures were very, very powerful for her. And it's not that we need to read into things a lot sometimes, but those three pictures were on the same batch of photos as these pictures here. And so they spoke to all of us in a sense, but I had no way to know of the impact that they had on Opal, because that night that I was with her and we testified about the accident and shared to this group of people at that church, she said that those photos helped her turn a corner, and that they were God's little message to her. That it was like God saying, listen, I know this is horrible and this hurts so much, but I wasn't out of control. I knew this was going to happen. This is part of my plan. You need to trust me, and I love you. And so I had no idea that photos that I was just running around taking pictures of things would be used in such a mighty way. And so again, God's gracious to do these little things for us, and for Opal, these photos were helpful, and I'm very, very thankful for that. These three photos and these two verses were shown at the funeral for Dave and Dan. And so now whenever I see Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, it means so much more to me. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. He wants us to trust Him, even when things like this happen. And especially, do not lean on your own understanding. That can lead to more bad things. It'll send you in a bad direction, trying to work things out in our own mind. We need to go to Scripture and learn about what God says for our lives there. In all your ways, acknowledge Him. Point to Him and His leading, and give Him credit for the things that He needs to be credited for. And He will direct your paths. And that is true. We've been able to encourage people and talk about this hardship, and yet give them an uplift and renew their faith, in a sense, give them some assurance of faith in hard times like this. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 just means so much after this hard time. So again, here's the crash pictures and the guys. And, you know, I've drawn many, many cartoons in the past that deal with serious topics. When it comes to death, I sometimes refer to this own instance in my own life. So I want to share with you a cartoon that I hope gives you some perspective on things that have happened in your life for us Christians that have the hope of Christ. So in this cartoon, this is the first panel. I depict the truck and the motorhome, and then Dan and Dave. And Bill is thinking about this event like we are today. We're remembering Dave and Dan and the sad event that took their lives. So Bill here is thinking about his brothers, Christians looking back at loss, looking just back a little bit in history, 40 years in this case. Look back in history even further. We look back 2,000 years ago when Christ fulfilled His promise in coming to this earth. God stepped into human flesh lived a perfect life, died on a cross in our place, the perfect one that didn't deserve to be punished at all for what I have done and what you have done, died on a cross, paid for that sin, died and rose again. And so we can look back at those events. And because we can look back at those events, then we can look forward. We can look forward to knowing that those that have received Christ, and Dave and Dan and Bill had, and so the hope of Christ, the hope of heaven, that assurance in Scripture that we read about is true. And I miss them now, but I don't have to miss them forever. I can see them again someday at the end of my life. And I look forward to that so much. And so that part gives us joy and hope and meaning, and we can share that with others and encourage them in their losses too. Again, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Dave and Dan are in that eternal life now, and I'm so thankful for that assurance. I remember the night that I found out that they had died and was thinking, I know where they are right now. And there's no amount of money that I would take and trade for that knowledge right now. That means so much to me. And then Revelation 21:4, whenever I hear this read, I always think of Dave and Dan. And it's talking about the future when things will be made different than they are right now. It says, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. Amen. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. We're living in a time right now that's not going to go on forever like this. God's going to bring to an end all those horrible things. And heaven, there's going to be two places that we're going to end up, heaven or hell. One of those two. And so my message to you today is receive Christ's free gift. Avoid the place everyone talks about and no one wants to go to. I want you in heaven in the future. I want to see you there, and I want you to see Dave and Dan, because I know they're there right now. I want to talk to you, end this presentation with this photo right here. There's some very, very interesting things about this photo. During our trip, when we made it to Chicago, we decided we're going to take a week break and go up. Bill's birthday is in October, and so we thought, let's take a week break, go back up, see our family and friends, take a little time off, and then after a week, we're going to go back down and continue the trip, which we did. During this week, Dave got to see his family, of course. So this picture was actually taken at the end of that week's break. And I had a photo or two on my camera, and so I thought, why don't I just finish off this roll, and then I can put in another roll of film and start afresh. So I said, hey, Dave, once you get your family together, we're just standing right outside the roller rink, and I said, let me take a couple pictures of you guys. And so they posed for me, and I took these pictures. We all had no idea that this was the last photo of this family ever taken together. And I was the one that took it. I was the last guy to see Dave alive, too. But there's four people in this picture that you know about. There's five people in this picture that I know about. See, during that break, there was a little baby that was conceived that Debbie found out after the accident. Somewhere down the road, a few weeks later, she found out she was expecting. And so little David Helwig was born. And so this is the only picture of those five that I know of that was taken of all of them together. You can't see little David, but I know he's there. My point in showing you this picture, though, is that, again, we had no idea that Dave's life was about to come to an end. None of us know when that's going to be. Some of us have an inkling if we have a disease and we're given a time frame. But I mean, my life could end in moments after I finish this video. I don't know, but I do know where I will be at the end of my life. My challenge to you is, do you have that same security? Do you have that same knowledge? What have you done with that free gift of salvation that's been offered to you? We're all sinners. Nobody, no matter how good you think you are, qualifies for heaven. God doesn't allow any sin in heaven at all. I sin more than once a day, and I think you're the same way. God doesn't want any of that in heaven, so you're not going there without his help. But God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Have you accepted that free gift? Have you received that free gift of salvation? I pray that you have. And if you haven't, check the link below. I want to give you more information on how you can do that. So it's been my honor and my privilege to share with you some more details about my dear friends, Dave and Dan Helwig. I love them dearly. I miss them so much, and I look forward to seeing them again in heaven, and I pray that you will too. Thanks for watching, and please share this video with those that you know. Thanks.